Okay, so been getting a few requests to do some more pencil videos, so that's what I'm gonna do today. This one I'll actually talk a little bit as I'm doing it. And to start, we'll talk about the materials that I'm gonna use. We'll have a 50% gray Prismacolor pencil. All these pencils are Prismacolors. I'll use a 70% gray. I will use a 90% gray. And I will use a black. Let's see if we can get a little better light on that for you guys. Doesn't really wanna. Well, you get the idea. 50, 70, 90, 100. Use a good old pink pearl eraser. Use a kneaded eraser. And then a couple more fine-tune erasers to do some detailed work. I might end up using an electric, depending on what we end up with. This is really good for erasing completely back to white, either like for detailed work, for can be good for like little sparks coming out of the fire or whatever. Then we'll also use a bit of Gamsol, which is just natural mineral spirits, usually used for oil painting as medium or a thinner. We're going to use this eventually with the pencil to create a base tone that we can then erase out of. And I'll smear it around with just a shop towel, just one of those blue towels that you get. So yeah, we will get started. I've been on a pirate kick lately, so we're just gonna run with that and keep going. Let's make sure that we can see everything that we're doing here. There. All right. So I'll use the 50% just to do a quick block in. And the way I tend to work is because I do sketching to aid in movie poster design. So I tend to, at this point, keep in mind the overall graphic quality for the just for the visual impact, that initial graphic design. So I'll block a lot of stuff in Silhouette just to get something interesting. But the whole time I'm very aware of what it is I'm gonna draw at the end. So, like I said, on a pirate kick, so we're just gonna run with that. And I'm thinking two pirates fighting on the decks. Maybe they've boarded another ship, and they're gonna loot it, do what pirates do. And I'll usually do this part fairly quickly. The way that I tend to work, I I don't like to spell everything out in the rough, because then it's all kind of done, and that's not very interesting to me. When I start to flesh it out in the finish, I like to have a little bit of mystery there still, and I like to be able to still figure things out. Otherwise, I'll just get kind of bored with it, and that will always show in a drawing. If the artist was bored, you're gonna pretty much end up with a boring drawing. And so anything you can do to make it interesting for yourself, in my case, it's just leaving some mystery and guesswork at every stage that I can. And you'll see, I'll switch up how I hold the pencil just depending on the kind of lines that I want or the angle. Especially with video, you can't really go and just turn things around as easily. And I don't tend to spin my paper or canvas around. I know a lot of people do. It's never really been my thing, but you know, whatever gets you to the result that you want. And when I'm blocking stuff in, I don't really have one particular way of working. Kind of just depends on my mood. Usually it will have to do with just keeping in mind the lighting. So I will tend to use a lot of shadow shapes to help me block in what I want. I'm a big fan of lighting, so I'm always really keeping that in mind. You know, sailors always used to talk about how it was bad luck to have women on the ship, but I don't think pirates really gave a shit about that. They just kind of did what they did. So this is kind of where I'll decide what kind of shapes I really want. And you know, one of the things, so pirates are one of my favorite things to draw. Also love drawing Vikings and just about anything Western. And a lot of it just has to do with the silhouettes and the shapes that you get to play with the kinds of clothes that they tended to wear. You know, cool coats and dangly things and flowy things, and it just makes for kind of fun action, right? So we'll get a cool coat on her. And we'll get something on him as well. Figure out where his sword's going here. So, I mean, the bulk of it won't really be much tighter than this at this phase. I won't really go into any detail until I'm actually finalizing the lines. Like I said, I don't like to figure it all out at this stage, because then it's like, well, kind of feels done. I'll make sure I have the little details. If I think of things along the way, I want to make sure I don't forget them. So I'll throw in the different landmarks that kind of indicate whatever items or expressions or whatever it is that I decide I want to add in there as I'm going through this. And if I feel like the underdrawing is getting a little too dark, I'll hit it with the eraser and just kind of lighten it up a bit. And what that does is it allows me to have a little more control in the modulation in the final drawing, where I may not want super dark lines in all of it. Unless it's a look I'm going for, I reserve that right. Long, flowy cuffs are always cool. She's got her musket pistol out. And I'm really just making this shit up as I go. I'm not necessarily going for any kind of insane period specific clothing. I know generally what they would have worn, but I'm just having fun, so I'm not trying to do any serious character design at this point. If I was, then I'd really do some research into not just the types of clothing, but a lot of the materials. Because, when you're doing character design, yes, you want to be fairly period specific, but you also want to just design something hopefully unique and cool. And so that's where sometimes you'll see a lot of, right now, a big thing is taking these period movies and sort of modernizing the clothing where it'll be modern style patterns and cuts, but with period accurate materials, right? Now, whether they could have actually done that at that time, who knows? Whether they had the tools to do it. Not really concerned, to be honest. Let's see. Ooh. Put them up. Just trying to think of where I might want to put them on the boat, have him coming down on a set of stairs. We'll assume this is, a big three master, good warship or something. A man of war. We'll get just a little bit of tilt on this and sell that ship feeling a bit more. Also, you'll rarely see me use a ruler or a straight edge. I like the organic look of a hand-done line, and unless something really calls for a perfectly straight line, I can get it straight enough. And that's kind of what matters. And at this time, most of this stuff would have been done by hand. It was not, didn't have skill saws and band saws and all that stuff. So a lot of it probably would have been handmade. So you can get away with a little bit of organicness. And again, I'm not trying to go for some super accurate ship. I've watched enough pirate stuff and researched things in the past when I needed to do some actual research, to where I'm mostly just concerned with getting shapes that make it that kind of make it feel like a ship. I don't know exactly where things would actually go, but I'm not really worried about that in this. This one is mostly about mood, more than anything else. And we'll probably get some other folks in here fighting, but we'll kind of flesh some of that stuff out. As we go, but we should get someone here in the foreground, right? At least give him somebody to fight. Maybe he's got his sword up too. And we'll probably hint at the wheel, because nothing says ship like a big ship steering wheel. That'll be cool. Yeah, so at this point, I will usually just start going to town, start fleshing it out. I'll lighten this stuff up a little bit, because it doesn't need to be so dark. This is usually the part that most people don't see, because it's not always interesting for everyone. But for any aspiring artists, maybe it's informative. I hope it's informative. So anyway, that's my blocking. So now we'll start on the real thing. All right. Let's see. When I'm doing this part of it, I'll usually hit the stuff in the foreground first. Sometimes I might start with the core area first and work my way out, but often I'll start with the foreground. That way, kind of, you can get it done and you know where the cutoff or overlap for other objects is. And I'll usually at least indicate shadow. It varies. It really varies depending on what I'm trying to achieve. Sometimes I will I'll do more shadow in this phase. Other times I'll keep it pretty sparse and wait till I'm using the Gamsol to really get it all in there, but I at least like to indicate some of it, and get some form happening, indication of form turning and that sort of thing. And I will, I'll draw with the side of the pencil as much as I can before really switching over to the tip of the pencil, which I'll mostly only use to pull out certain details. I'd like to be more lighting and shape oriented for as much of the process as I can. and working with the side of the pencil, it kind of allows me to hit broad shapes. One, a little more geometrically, so to speak, making sure that the overall read is what I want, and I guess not so much not geometrically, structurally is that's the word I was looking for. Allows me to kind of focus more on the overall structure rather than getting caught up in details that may or may not matter. For the most part, with a lot of this, at least this kind of sketching, probably only need to really detail out, for all intents and purposes, this area. As long as the other information is at least indicated, this is all anyone's really gonna care about. So, I'm not terribly concerned with getting crazy with everything else. It's mostly indication, and what that comes down to, it's not... I'll see a lot of people try and indicate, and it's a learning process. It's not just about, oh, look at this cool, way easier method of shortcutting. It's not that, because indication still requires a lot of a knowledge on the artist's part, right? Indication is all about understanding the form language of whatever it is you're drawing or painting, right? So it's and when it comes to sketching like that, it's you're trying to say an extreme amount of things, a lot of different things with one tool. So it kind of becomes about every mark that you make needs to be able to say five different things depending on how you use that mark, right? If that makes any sense. I hope it does. I'm not crazy. So, you know, when you are indicating, you need to know the fundamental structure of what it is you're drawing, and what are the core ideas, what are the core shapes in that thing that make it feel like that thing, right? All right, let's get into these guys. So this is where you kind of want to make sure that you know what your light source is and where it's coming from. Thinking it's coming somewhere from the upper left. But maybe not too high up, just so I can cheat the shadows of the hats. I don't want to totally obscure their faces, although a little bit could be cool, add some mystery. And as much as I can, some details warrant coming in like this, but as much as I can, I really want to pull or push the line, you're just going to get a much more elegant line weight, I guess. And I mean, hell, if we're not going for elegance, what are we doing, right? So then, because I have this just enough information, what this allows me to do is then decide where I want to edit, right? And that's one of the most important things, because when it comes to drawing, it's like, I mean, same with music. What you don't say is sometimes more important than what you do say. And so you need to, you have to be able to choose, right? And this is what I was meaning when I say I tend to work a lot in silhouette, and I pay a lot of attention to that, right? Because, so at this point, I understand what I'm going for. So then what I'll often do is I'll just come in and cut in that silhouette, because this is really what I care about. The few interior details, just make sure I know exactly where my anchor points are, because the other thing is when you're working small, you don't have a lot of leeway, right? I mean, if things are 2 millimeters off, it's not going to look right. And again, this is where your knowledge of form and form language comes in, because I don't want to spell everything out, but it needs to look right. Okay, if you detail the shit out of everything, like at least half the time, I feel like, who cares? So what? So you had enough time to just spell everything out and not let us use any imagination. And that's just not that interesting to me. I want to see a bit more of the artist's hand. I want to see the choices that they're making, because to me that's way more interesting. That is where I get to decide, like, wow, is this person making awesome decisions or not? Or are they just putting everything in so then they don't have to make any decisions? And then, you know, whoop-de-shit. Okay, so, this is the interesting information to me. And then, again, I get to come in and decide what is important, what gets fleshed out, what doesn't. But I still won't come in with a crazy amount of detail right now. So for drama and for graphic design, one of your strongest assets is shadow shapes, right? You know, one of the, obviously, if you're familiar with Frank Miller, the thing that people respond to so much, other than, storytelling, is the graphic design, and that all comes from shadow shapes, pulling from the kind of that noir aesthetic, right? And you see, like, I mean, there's nothing going on, but you understand what's happening with that hand. But if you're really to zoom in on that, it's not like a super rendered anything, so it would go pretty abstract. So that's kind of where your form language knowledge comes in. Let's get indication of this cuff in there. And you can kind of come in loose, kind of quick and dirty with stuff if you understand what it is that you're drawing. If you don't, then no one else is. And then I'll come back and kind of decide where I want more detail. If I want more detail in an area. Right. Don't be afraid to just leave things out. In art, we call that lost and found. Lost edges and found edges, and people go ape shit over it. I'm sorry, it makes it sound like a total gimmick, and it's not. It's, again, it all comes down to the choices that we make as artists, and that is kind of what defines us individually. Like when you're talking about an artist's individual style, right? It's all, if we all use the same tools, but can still manage to get different looking, I got that railing, different looking images from the same tool, then, what that's coming from is each artist's, one, their personal life experience, but we're not going to get that esoteric with it. It's kind of silly. I'm just drawing pirates. But they're just their choices as an artist. That's kind of what then defines each person's style. So we all have things that we'll start to gravitate toward, right? I like pirates. And generally, like anything that tends to be more organic. I like drawing that stuff. In recent years, I have developed a liking for mechanical shapes, but honestly, it took years. I hated drawing anything mechanical forever. Sorry, I hate these shapes. I don't know what I was thinking. Sorry. One of the main things. I'm working on Duralene. It's an acetate made by Seth Cole. It's like a high-end vellum or tracing paper, but because it's acetate, you don't have to worry about chewing up the paper. You can erase and erase and erase and erase and erase and erase, and it won't go anywhere. It's plastic. For all intents and purposes, it's plastic. And so as a result, I can draw with Prismacolor and completely erase it afterward. Right back to white, so to speak. I have piece of white paper under it to keep it white. Otherwise, it's translucent, as you can see. It's like tracing paper. It's what I use in a lot of my work because it's very forgiving. And you'll see when I start to throw the tone on, you'll see kind of the power of it. But anything I'm doing here, you can also do with tracing paper or vellum, because Durlene is not cheap. So unless you have the budget for it, it's not for everyone. So tracing paper can do if that's what you need to work with. Like you say, anything I'm doing here, you could do on tracing paper. And a lot of people do professionally. The main reason I don't use tracing paper is that I don't like the tooth on it. Not for what I do. I tend to draw a little smaller. Anything with a lot of tooth doesn't lend itself very well to small details. I also have a sanding block clipped to the upper corner of my drawing board, so I don't have to sharpen my pencil all the time. I can sand a tip back on, or I can sand it flat, and I don't have to actually chew up the pencil in the sharpener. So it just makes it last a bit longer, and I don't have to go through. For a while, I would go through sometimes a couple pencils in a day, just from the amount of sharpening. I also use a smudge guard when I draw. I'm not worried really about smudging Prismacolor, though you can if your hand starts to sweat or anything like that. But I like the smudge guard just because I want my hand to be able to move freely. If I'm doing any kind of flowing lines, I need to know that my hand isn't going to catch on the paper. Because of where that light's coming from, her whole brim of that hat will be in shadow pretty much. And we'll add a bit of detail to her face just for interest. Or visual interest, but for now, make sure all these pirates are having fun. Bastard scallywags that they are. Right, so I'll do same thing with her, but we won't forget The feathers this time. Any little flourishes you can add, a little bit of showing that these are two separate things buttoned together. It goes a long way, just to selling the idea. And again, I'm not concerned with every little detail. Just want the idea to come across and at least be convincing. The most of this stuff is just making sure that no one looks at it and thinks it looks wrong, right? That's something I'll often say, probably mostly to myself. If it doesn't look wrong, it's right. Doesn't say pirate if you don't show some bosom, right? You can have like a kind of a tailcoat deal. And I won't block in all the shadows at this point yet. I mostly just want to make sure that when I work with the Gamsol, that I have an understanding of where they're gonna be. So I just want enough to where I'm not having to do a lot of guesswork. At that stage. And you see, working with the side of the pencil, I was able to do this much at least before I actually needed to put my pencil in the sharpener. And so that's, one of the reasons that I will use that sanding block. But also comes from just working with the side of the pencil, which will ultimately give you just nicer lines. But I will change the tip of the pencil when I'm doing some more detailed work. At this point, I will switch to 70% gray. I know it looks really dark. You can see it's a 70% gray. Cool gray, mind you. I don't use the French gray or the warm gray. You can. I just feel like the cool gray goes better with the black, because the black tends to be a little bit of a cooler black. So it just makes sense to me to use cool gray. But I'm going to use 70% gray for the stuff that's in the background. And I'm really just going to indicate these guys. I'm not trying to get into fleshing out, seven different figures. I'll leave that for work. When you work designing stuff for, something that has a cast of six, seven, eight, nine people. Every sketch has to have that many people. It gets tiring, but it's also a really fun challenge. So I just kind of want to indicate these dudes. Brawling and doing whatever they're doing. Most of it, so again, when we get down to indication, you just need enough information to where your mind or the viewer's mind can fill in the blanks. That's it. You don't need to detail the hell out of everything. Just enough so that they're not completely lost, looking at everything. I want this. Wanted to cut this wall down just to make room for at least a little bit of rigging, because if you're not drawing rigging, then why put them on a ship? Oops, and we should probably make sure that our perspective is at least a little bit on, right? And some of this stuff I'll just end up kind of indicating and hinting at with the shadows when I get into really blocking that stuff in. Because it doesn't need to all be there spelled out. So let's get some more dudes. Homie's got a ponytail, something. This is where, I mean, just get some gestures in there. He's facing away from us. Got his cutlass, and maybe he's got a knife in that backhand. These guys were bold and boarded a soldier's ship, I guess. Probably not the smartest move, but oh well. They're in it for the fun. Okay. I think I will probably then detail some stuff out, and then we'll get into the actual tone. And I don't want to go overboard, right? Because, again, what you don't say is more important oftentimes. Not, I mean, you know, there's exceptions to every rule. I'm not gonna give you any absolutes, but don't be afraid to leave stuff out. But this is where you can add, you know, all kinds of little flourishes. Little details go a long way. And if you just focus on these focal points, then the rest you can really let fall away and no one will question it. As long as the important stuff looks awesome. You can also take a lot of cues. I take a lot of cues from film and photography, in that you can kind of, I mean, if you wanted to, you could build in something that looks like a rack focus, or you are actually blurring things outside the focal area, but you can also play with it with line weight. You know, if I put kind of a thicker line around this stuff that's in the foreground, it'll kind of bring it forward, and I can also simplify it so that it kind of gives this fake illusion of it being out of focus without you actually having to try and draw blurry, because that's just a pain in the ass. You can if you want. It's all you. And of course, with female characters, it gets a little tricky because you actually want to almost use as little information as possible. Or unless you're trying to, you know, go for someone that has a lot of character, so to speak. So, you know, with. But we're going for a pretty pirate girl. Don't know if those ever existed, but maybe they did. Seems like a pretty hard life. So who knows where that led them. My guess is they did not look like Elizabeth Swann. Give her some striped pantaloons. And so then here, where it's not a focal object, I won't actually go in and do interior detail. I will just run the pencil around the silhouette. And pretty much let that do the heavy lifting. All right, let's throw some tone on this bad boy. To do that, we flip it over, because we're going to do the tone on the back, right? Because we're working with a translucent paper, so we can work on the back and know that the tone will show through. Alright, I'll move this over. Got off center there. Good enough. This is where I will come in with my 90% gray. 90% cool gray. Quick and dirty. There is no finesse at this part. Won't help you. Then come in. This is where I bring out my gamsol, shop towel, and just put a few drops on there. It's a new towel, so it'll need to absorb some of this, but it will just melt away, not away, but it will as because I'll use the, you can use the same shop towel for multiple drawings. And as you do, you'll see it'll start to build up. The layer of pencil. Once it does, it's easier to work with. Initially, sometimes it takes a little finessing to get to where you want to go. This looks really dark. There we go. All right. A little more. A little more Gamsol on here, and there we go. And you can either go really smooth with this tone, or you can leave some texture in it, which can be fun for some visual interest. And I might do that. You can just come in, like we do one drop on here, and just kind of come in and dirty this up a little bit. Some of that'll kind of show through a bit. Then we can just let this dry for a couple minutes. And then get back to it. Okay, dry-ish. Dry enough. So I just want to carve out some of the silhouettes back here. When it's not completely dry, it's much easier to lift it back to white. So if there are any parts that right now I'm kind of bringing it back to the sky, right? So I want that to be white, more or less. Just cleaning the eraser. And it's, again, right now, it's not a precision part of the process, not super precise anyway. It's just hitting the big shapes. And I want there are silhouettes to pop a little more, so I'm just gonna lighten up stuff behind them. And I will also come back in with that 90% and darken some things up where I want them to be darker. In fact, we can do that right now. You'll see it all make more sense once we flip this back. There's a bit of just knowing where this is gonna go, right? A lot of kind of trial and error, I guess. So it's just bearing in mind how this stuff is gonna look when I flip it back over. Okay, it'll be a lot softer, the tone. So these marks I'm making aren't going to be so prevalent. Not like they are right now, anyway. Come in, get some hot, some highlights. These swords. Okay, so this is where this little eraser comes in handy. Pulling out the details. It really doesn't take much. And you can see how much more leeway there is, right, before you hit white. So there's a lot of room to play with some pretty subtle modulation in value. You can do some pretty significant rendering if you want to. And it's pretty fun because it's forgiving. If you don't like it, you can just come back over with a Gamsol and kick it all back down to a single tone and try it all again, because the drawing will always be there on the other side, right? I'll use the pink pearl when I want generally a little bit more of an edge on something. Where the kneaded eraser, you know, can deform a lot easier. Want that wheel to pop forward more. Same with this guy. So this is a 70% gray. The nice thing about working with the different percentages is that if I'm working with the 70% gray, I know no matter what I do, it's not going to go darker than 70%. So in that sense, I have a lot of control. Because I know what the limit of that particular tool is. Actually want to bring these guys darker. So we're gonna do that. All right, there's probably still a little bit of just to pop them forward a bit. The one thing you need to watch out for is texture. It's nice sometimes to get some cool texture going on, but you also want to make sure that it's not distracting where you don't want it to be. So that looks a little better. So first thing, like 10th thing should have been the first thing. Just making sure that these silhouettes are reading more or less how I want them to read. So that has a better read. It's a little dark on the screen. That looks better. All right. Sorry, I got a phone call. I'm recording this on my phone, so I haven't got a phone call. So what I'm trying to do here, all I'm trying to do is basically just giving myself some separation between the lights and the darks. It's nothing crazy, just that's all it is, just some separation between the lights and the darks. And then I'll come in, or now I'll come in and kind of decide, okay, I want this to be, the local value is lighter. This thing maybe is stays darker. And we can get a little bit of air, a bit of space in those shadows too, just for fun. And because we have our drawing on the front, which is really, it's really gonna be doing the heavy lifting for us. And you'll see once I flip it back over. I don't need to be super precise. You can if you want. It just depends on how long you want to spend on a drawing. Sometimes it's really fun to do that, to just go to town and render the shit out of it. But, oftentimes when I'm doing this stuff for work, one, I'm not talking while I'm doing it. That always makes things go a little slower. But I usually will only have, I can only afford to spend anywhere from an hour to 2 hours on one piece most of the time. Because we've got to get 25 of them done in 5 days, and so I usually need to knock out about five or so in a day most of the time. Sometimes we can take a little more time on it. This kind of stuff is great. Like this, you for just adding kind of little, just indicating details, right? Remember, it doesn't have to actually be anything. It just needs to look like it's something. So that's usually what I care about. And probably gonna wrap this up pretty soon. I'm not gonna go really crazy with it. Make sure these guys' silhouettes read. Because, again, silhouettes are everything. I don't remember where that other dude's sword was, but whatever. is a 90% gray. Just for getting some accented darks in here. These dark accents are great for just adding a bit of depth when you flip it back over, because they'll soften out a little bit. They won't be as harsh as they are on the front, right? So I'll say he's got an awesome leather coat, so we'll give it a little bit of that kind of leather sort of shine. Sorry, I don't know if there is such thing as vegan pirates. It's all indication, just as long as it looks like it could be something that's all that really matters. Chances are, if it doesn't look wrong, it's right enough. It's right enough. So I used to use that electric eraser a lot more. I think that was before I actually got this little guy. I will still use the electric eraser for certain kinds of detail. If I have, like, say there's a candle burning or something like that, to just get that white hot aspect, it works really well. And that's what I'll use it for. But otherwise, sometimes it because it pretty much goes right back to white right away, and I tend to like to have a little more control over the tone than that. So yeah. All right. Let's see what this looks like. Moment of truth. Moment of truth. Hey, this one's too shabby. Move it over there for you. Yeah. Say that looks pretty nice. And this is where then I can kind of, if I want parts to smooth out, I can actually come in with a 70% gray, because the way the Prismacolor works, if you come over with a lighter color, if you draw over a dark color with a lighter color, it kind of smears it in a way. And you can get a nice sort of buttery smooth look to it. ish. It also depends on how hard you press. If you don't press very hard, you'll tend to get more grain showing through. I will sometimes I'll use a white if I want to just pull out some little details. But I don't usually, but sometimes it's fun just to do little flourishes and whatnot. Back that 70%. Reinforce some of these shadows a little bit. And again, you could go way more detailed than this. Sometimes I do, if the situation calls for it. It is a lot of fun because it's such a forgiving technique. It's really hard to. The only way you can mess it up is if you really mess up in the structure of the drawing and you have to do the whole drawing over again. Otherwise, pretty much most of this, at any point, you can take back a few steps without having to go all the way back to the beginning, and redo them, and do it right if you happen to fuck it up along the way. Right, so there's our scallywags. You know what we're missing? And we have to do it because no ship battle is complete without it. We need some smoke. We need smoke. Because otherwise, it just looks so tame. So I'll use a 90% because I can go light with it if I want. It'll just be more subtle or. Where do we want the smoke? Or I can go darker. And it just kind of, again, just indicating might come in with the Gamsol. Mess with that a little bit. Just a little, need much. And with this smoke, we then have a little bit of kind of have an excuse to get some far in there, right? Shit's on fire. Gives an excuse for this guy. Get some sparks flying. Alright, gives us an excuse to carve out some of this. And whether I like it or not, I'm a big fan of rim lighting, but you also want to make sure that you have a reason for it. You don't necessarily want to fabricate reasons, but you know, if it works within the story, fuck it, do it. Helps to pop them out, pop them forward. Separate them, give us a nice clear focal point. Why not?
Done.